The Harris-Todaro model is used to explain some of the issues in rural-urban migration. The model asserts that wage distortions in the urban sector cause urban unemployment and that an equilibrium will be reached when the expected wage in urban areas equals the actual wage of a rural worker. And the expected wage of a worker in the urban area comprises the actual wage that she could earn in the urban area, multiplied by the probability that she would find a job, plus 1 minus the probability of finding a job, times the wage that you would earn if you did not find a job in the urban sector. Let me call that the urban formal sector, and the WIU is the urban informal sector. If you assume that there is no informal sector, the wage you would earn if you did not land a job in the urban formal sector would be zero, and the equation would be simplified to say W star R equals P times WU. And you would see how the equation would reduce to the probability P equals the rural wage divided by the urban wage in the sector that paid higher. So we can see that P, the probability, is fractional, which, as we said earlier, means that the rural wage is lower than the urban wage. Continuing, migration from rural to urban areas will increase if any of the following three phenomena occur. First, if the urban wage increases. Secondly, migration from rural to urban area will increase if urban unemployment declines, or if urban employment increases. So if P increases, you'd expect more people to migrate to the urban area. The probability of finding an urban job is higher, so more people would take the chance to come to the urban area. If we have two factors of production, labor and capital, in the urban sector, if capital is artificially cheap, priced below market clearing, for example, and labor is made artificially expensive in the urban area, capital-intensive techniques will be promoted and employed. If you can get cheaper capital and workers are expensive, why would you hire the expensive worker rather than using the cheaper capital? So at some level, Harris and Todaro are saying that it's because the urban sector has this distortion, paying too high a wage for workers in the urban area, which causes the migration, by the way, and the capital is held cheap by whatever mechanism. It could be the banks are charging low interest rates, or the government is subsidizing the importation of capital or the use of capital. If factor prices are distorted such that capital is cheap, think free, and labor is expensive, then workers would find themselves unemployed. And this could be part of the explanation for why we have urban unemployment. As far as factor price distortions go, such factor price distortions usually result from some form of government action. Artificially high minimum wages, government support of trade union demands, or high wages to encourage worker efficiency. There is an interesting argument in labor economics called the efficiency wage hypothesis, and it goes like this. If I pay you a really high wage, you will love the job so much, or you will so cherish the job that you don't want to lose it, and therefore you will give 110% at that job. Secondly, the net social welfare benefits of this policy is usually negative. Economists, pretty much to a person, believe that free markets will create efficiency outcomes, and if you do anything to move away from free markets, you will be reducing the net social welfare in society. The net social welfare benefits of factor price distortions are usually negative, since the beneficiaries are generally small groups of workers who are well organized, while the substitution effect displaces some and draws other workers from the rural area. Urban unemployment is made worse by an increase in the urban-rural wage differential, an increase in the number of modern sector urban jobs, indiscriminate educational expansion as employers use the higher educational qualifications as a rationing device for employment. This forces students to seek additional qualifications to obtain jobs that do not need such high levels of education. To the extent that rural families migrate to urban areas on the basis of labor market prospects of one person, usually the adult male, The opportunity cost of the second adult's time spent in domestic productivity usually falls. The female in the urban area will have fewer children due to the explicit cost of having more, as well as the opportunity cost. The explicit cost, the space that you will have in the rural area is greater. So with smaller space, there is part of the opportunity cost. In the urban area, you have to conform to the principles and the mores, so your kids have to go to school and be dressed halfway decent. And the mother would also be expecting to have options of her own in the urban sector. Therefore, the opportunity cost of her time would be important to the equation. So you expect smaller families in urban areas. We should encourage programs of integrated rural development. Secondly, eliminate the factor price distortions where possible. I say secondly, I probably should have listed that first, because economists, again, almost a person, believe that free markets will yield the best results. And if you have distortions, you should remove them as soon as possible so the economy can reach its efficiency. Shortcomings of the Harris-Todaro model. By expressing the expected wage of the rurally-based potential migrant in terms of the modern sector wage, it assumes that the potential migrant has the ability to gain employment in a modern sector. In practice, those who migrate are those who have the skills and those who want to get the skills. So you end up with a situation where more people migrate to the urban area, and this causes the urban unemployment. The analysis presented here points to the importance of factor prices for resource allocation and employment creation, and the urban bias inherent in policies designated to promote industrialization at the expense of agriculture.